Macmillan Audio presents Collision of Power, Trump, Bezos, and the Washington Post by Martin Baron. Read for you by Liev Schreiber, with a prologue and epilogue from the author.
Prologue. The White House, June 15, 2017. The dinner with President Trump was to be kept confidential. He wouldn't talk about it. We wouldn't either. Our reporting staff was to be kept in the dark, and to this day the meeting has never been reported. No one in the newsroom ever suggested to me they were aware of it. Reporters who had dug up many secrets about the Trump White House somehow missed this one. The black SUV with tinted windows carrying Jeff Bezos, owner of the Washington Post, would be allowed onto the White House grounds at 6:50 p.m., waved in through a wrought iron vehicle entrance gate, so that he could enter without being observed. On that clear June evening in 2017, with temperatures in the low 80s, the Post's publisher, Fred Ryan, its editorial page editor, Fred Hyatt, and I, as the executive editor who oversaw news coverage, would walk up to a gate at the northeast corner of the White House grounds, avoiding the northwest gate, where we would almost certainly be spotted by journalists entering and exiting. This was not a dinner I was looking forward to. I had not met Trump, even though our reporters had spent many hours with him. Except for natural curiosity, I didn't feel a need to. I could assess him on what he said and did. And what good would come from spending time with him that evening? Surely he would see dinner as a favor and expect something in return. And surely he would conclude from our visit as a group that Bezos had a hand in news coverage. Although Ryan had proposed the meeting to the White House, he sought to allay my concerns about how Trump would interpret it. He assured me that he had made one thing clear. The White House should not expect this get-together to influence coverage. And yet why else would the White House agree to have us over for dinner if Trump felt he had nothing to gain? Ryan was taken with the idea of getting together face-to-face. Leadership of the dominant news organization in the nation's capital should meet with the new leader of the country. Ryan had even broached the idea of holding the meeting at his own home. Not likely. And sure enough, the White House said no. Trump would not be coming to us. We would go to him, 5 months into his position as the most powerful person on the planet. If word leaked out and there were press inquiries about the presence of the Post's owner, Bezos suggested just saying he was invited, rather than, as a pre-written statement worded it, that it was appropriate for him to attend. We must have been an odd-looking group. Bezos, the impressively fit Amazon founder, who was among the richest people in the world, recognizable anywhere for his bald head, short stature, booming laugh, and radiant intensity. Ryan, an alumnus of the Reagan administration, who was a head taller than my own 5'11", with his graying blonde hair and a giant, glistening smile. Hyatt, a 36-year Post veteran and former foreign correspondent, with an earnest and bookish look. And me, still a relative newcomer to the Post, with a trimmed gray beard, woolly head of hair, and what was invariably described as my dour and taciturn demeanor. We were politely welcomed by Trump, First Lady Melania Trump, and son-in-law Jared Kushner. Ivanka Trump had planned to be with us, but instead attended the annual congressional baseball game, where thousands prayed for Representative Steve Scalise of Louisiana, who had been shot and severely injured the previous day during a practice game in Alexandria, Virginia. The shooter was a Trump hater. Although Trump had visited MedStar Washington Hospital Center, where Scalise was in critical condition, he appeared at the game only on a big screen. "By playing tonight," he declared, "you are showing the world that we will not be intimidated by threats, acts of violence, or assaults on our democracy. The game will go on. I know you all will be playing extra hard tonight for Steve." Ivanka's place setting was removed from the table in the blue room, an egg-shaped reception room with blue and gold accents and a lavish chandelier, suggesting a last-minute decision on her part to attend the game, where media took particular note of her formal wear. I wondered why Trump himself had opted to be with us rather than at the game. A strong supporter of his was in the hospital receiving blood transfusions and undergoing surgeries. A bullet had entered Scalise's hip, the hospital reported, traveling across his pelvis, fracturing bones, injuring internal organs, and causing severe bleeding. His survival was in doubt. The baseball game provided a rare opportunity for bipartisanship. The president could have seized on the moment. Trump's press secretary at the time, Sean Spicer, later cited security reasons for Trump's absence from the game. Maybe so, but the president's image could not have been enhanced if at such a fraught moment the public knew he chose to spend his time with the very sorts of media people whom he called the lowest form of life. Away from the memorial, Trump would pass the evening with us, crowing about his election victory, mocking his rivals and even some in his own orbit, boasting already of imagined accomplishments, calculating how he could win yet again in 4 years, and describing the Washington Post as the worst of all media outlets. As we dined on cheese souffle, pan-roasted Dover sole, and chocolate cream tart, he went on to disparage other media outlets. The New York Times came in just behind us in his ranking at the time, whose journalists he had labeled for months as scum and garbage. As our visit commenced at 7 p.m., the Post published a report that was likely to secure our number one spot for a while. Special Counsel Robert S. Mueller III was inquiring into Kushner's business dealings in Russia, part of his investigation into that country's interference in the 2016 election. The story landed on top of a previous one by the Post that revealed Kushner had met secretly with Russian Ambassador Sergei Kislyak and had proposed that a Russian diplomatic post be used to provide a secure communications line between Trump officials and the Kremlin. The Post had reported as well that Kushner met later with Sergei Gorkov, head of a Russian-owned development bank. Jamie Gorelick, one of Kushner's lawyers, who was also a director of Amazon, had previously called me to push back against the idea that her client was the focus or subject of an investigation. Kushner, for his part, was bristling at the attention, both from investigators and the press. He had called and emailed my boss, Ryan, fretting over what headlines might say, and labeling as jackasses the national security reporters who were digging into his Russia contacts. He followed up with a series of agitated emails, even copying in Bezos, looping in Jamie, who can vouch on this with Jeff since she knows him well, read one. While declining to speak directly to the reporters involved and steadfastly avoiding communication directly with me. In a meeting later that week with White House correspondents Philip Rucker and Ashley Parker, as well as national editor Steven Ginsburg, he had pounded a table in fury, wailing about the good life he and Ivanka had left behind in New York and the potential injury to his reputation. As the Post journalists made their exit, Kushner patted Steven on the back, declaring, well, that was therapeutic. Also annoyed was Trump, who at our White House dinner derided what he had been hearing about our story on the special counsel and his son-in-law, suggesting incorrectly that it alleged money laundering. He's a good kid, he said of Kushner, who at the time was 36 and a father of three. As we were about to take our seats, 28-year-old Trump aide Hope Hicks handed Kushner her phone. Our alert had just gone out, reaching millions of mobile devices, no doubt including hers. Very Shakespearean, she whispered to Kushner, dining with your enemies. Hyatt whispered back, we're not your enemies. But Trump, his family, and his team had affixed us on their enemies list, and nothing was going to change anyone's mind. We had been neither servile nor sycophantic toward Trump, and we weren't going to be. Our job was to report aggressively on the president and to hold his administration, like all others, to account. In the mind of the president and those in his orbit, that most fundamental journalistic obligation made us the opposition. There was political benefit to Trump in going further. We would not just be his enemy, we would be the country's enemy. In his telling, we would be traitors. Less than a month into his presidency, Trump had denounced the press as the enemy of the American people on Twitter. It was an ominous echo of the phrase invoked by Joseph Stalin, Mao Zedong, and Hitler's propagandist, Joseph Goebbels, and deployed for the purpose of repression and murder. Trump could not have cared less about the history of such incendiary language, or how it might incite physical attacks on journalists. And it was clear from that moment, if it had not been earlier, that he saw all of us at that table as his foes. Not just me as the one who directed news reporting, not just Fred Hyatt as the one who separately oversaw editorials, but also Fred Ryan, who was our superior as publisher, and Jeff Bezos. Perhaps most especially Bezos, because he owned the Post, and in Trump's mind was pulling the strings, or could pull them if he wished. At our dinner, though, Trump sought to be charming. It was a superficial charm, entirely without warmth or authenticity. He did almost all the talking. We scarcely said a word, and I said the least out of discomfort at being there and seeking to avoid any direct confrontation with him over coverage in front of Bezos and Ryan. Anything I said could set him off. Since I didn't see any good that could come out of the meeting, perhaps at least I could avoid the bad. Why risk fireworks between us? We'd agreed to keep this meeting off the record, and yet Trump has by now said publicly largely everything he said then in private. What's more, we were exploiting an administration policy the Post itself had editorially condemned, Trump's refusal to follow President Obama's practice of releasing voluminous records on who visited the White House. In an April 2017 editorial titled The Secret Presidency, the Post declared that Trump's decision to claw the White House logs back into the shadows follows several other moves that show contempt for the public. We were now party to one of those secrets. Trump's public statements since render moot the confidentiality accorded his comments, and to continue maintaining the secrecy of the meeting itself would be an act of persistent hypocrisy. With the passing of years, nothing said at the meeting will still shock. Trump's rhetoric became only more inflammatory. His self-aggrandizement became only more routine. His belittlement of senior members of his administration became a signature of his presidency. At the dinner, he let loose on a long list of perceived enemies and slights. The chief executive of Macy's was a coward for pulling Trump products from store shelves in reaction to Trump's remarks portraying Mexican immigrants as rapists. He would have been picketed by only 20 Mexicans. Who cares? He had better relations with foreign leaders than Obama, who was lazy and never called them. Obama left disasters around the world for him to solve. Obama was hesitant to allow the military to kill people in Afghanistan. He told the military to just do it. Don't ask for permission. Egypt needed a rough guy like President Abdel Fattah el-Sisi. Otherwise, the country would be a disaster. And foreshadowing Trump's remarks revealed in a book by Barak Ravid, released almost a year after he departed the White House, the president said he was surprised to find that the Palestinians wanted a peace deal more than the Israelis. Fresh from visiting several weeks earlier with Palestinian Authority President Mahmoud Abbas in Bethlehem and Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu in Jerusalem, Trump took note of the billions of dollars in aid the United States provided Israel and acknowledged asking early on whether it couldn't be leveraged to pressure Israel to make peace. "I was told there's no connection," he said. He was incredulous. No connection? Attorney General Jeff Sessions, fired FBI Director James Comey, former Deputy FBI Director Andrew McCabe, and Special Counsel Robert Mueller were slammed for reasons that are now familiar. Defense Secretary Jim Mattis was the best. He'd later call him the most overrated general. Trump went on at length about how devastating nuclear weapons could be, how the entire South would be demolished if Miami were hit, how Amazon would be turned to shit if Seattle were targeted. By his accounting, Russia's nuclear weapons were all new and worked well. Not like ours, but we're going to fix that. And there was no real harm in being friends with Vladimir Putin, the Russian president. No one really knew for sure, he said, whether Russia was behind the election interference in 2016. He promised to soon deliver a better healthcare plan, a big tax cut, and a major infrastructure plan. One of three turned out to be true. As Trump meandered from one subject to the next, Jared sat straight, impassive, and almost entirely uncommunicative.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.